In this video, you'll learn how to encrypt your Asterisk endpoints with md5 secret. Before we start replacing our passwords, it is worth noting that the md5 secret consists of three parts: username, realm, and password. To check the realm for SIP channels, go to the console and execute SIP show settings. And for PJSIP, it will be PJSIP show settings. In both cases, we will see the default asterisk realm. To change it globally, we can do it in etc asterisk asterisk.conf by adding or editing the realm variable. So let's encrypt our passwords starting from the SIP channel. Let's edit our file using nano etc asterisk sip.conf. Inside, you will find our local SIP extensions with assigned passwords. To change the first of them, for example, the 100 extension, let's copy our password. Let's close the nano editor and encode the password with the command echo hyphen m and then inside quotation username 100 colon our realm asterisk colon our password, and then after pipe md5 sum. We add hyphen n to echo so that the command doesn't add a new line to the end of the variable, thus generating the wrong md5 string. Now we will return to the file etc asterisk sip.conf and let's delete the line with the secret and add md5 secret and paste the generated string. Now in the asterisk CLI, let's perform a SIP reload to reload the changes. Now by executing SIP show users, we will see that our password for the 100 extension is no longer visible. If it is any consolation, the SIP show users command only shows the first 15 characters of the password. So if you're using longer passwords, which is recommended, the command does not reveal longer passwords. What is worth mentioning, if your configuration will contain a regular secret and md5 secret, the md5 secret takes precedence. For PJSIP, the principle is very similar. Let's go to the etc asterisk pjsip.conf file. As you can see, unlike SIP, PJSIP breaks down endpoint information into several elements. As described on the official website of Asterisk, the password for the endpoint is in the auth context. In our case, for let's say the 200 extension, the auth context shows our current password in a password variable. Unfortunately, if we execute pjsip show auth 200 in the CLI, we will see it. So let's copy the password and generate the md5 string in the same way. Echo hyphen m and inside quotation 200 asterisk password for 200 and after pipe md5 sum. Now let's copy the string, and now what we need to do is to change two things in etc asterisk pjsip file. In the auth type variable, we define the password type. If you don't see it, it has the default value user pass. Let's change the plain password, this user pass, to md5. And then instead of having password, we will use md5 underscore cred from credential and paste our string. Let's go back to the console, and unfortunately, as of today, for PJSIP, there is no simple PJSIP reload. So let's reload the module with module reload res underscore pjsip.so. Now our earlier pjsip show auth 200 command will show that we are using md5 credentials and it will no longer be possible to read it. Well, unless someone reviews your action history. So about that, if you have already programmed your phones and you don't want someone to see your passwords generated for your endpoints, you should always edit your command history, because doing tilde and then forward slash dot bash history we'll display our attempts to generate the passwords. However, let's face it, if anyone can see your bash history, you already have a serious problem. So by now you should know how to implement MD5 secrets instead of plaintext passwords. And there are some benefits of using MD5. For example, those passwords actually disappeared from our Asterisk console and they were visible only at the time of generating them. However, MD5 is not that commonly used. For example, unless you're using TLS registration, those passwords are still being sent over the network in plain text. Also, MD5 is not the most secure method of encryption, because although officially you cannot reverse engineer it, it's still prone to brute force attacks. So be cautious. So I'm hoping you found this material useful. More about MD5, as usual, on our website, hotkey404.com. Link in the description. And also, if you think there is some cool application of MD5 that maybe I haven't thought about, feel free to write about this in the comment section. So I'm hoping you enjoyed it and see you in the next one.